Welcome to the City Club of Cleveland. I'm Nelson Weiss, president of the City Club. Today we are pleased to have with us as our speaker Mr. Earl G. Graves, the distinguished publisher of Black Enterprise magazine. Mr. Graves is a nationally recognized authority on Black business development. His magazine presently has a readership of more than 1.25 million persons. Mr. Graves, who heads 6 corporations, including radio stations and research companies, was named in 1972 one of the 10 most outstanding minority businessmen in the country by the President of the United States, and presented the National Award of Excellence in recognition of his achievements in minority business enterprise. In 1974, Time magazine named him one of the 200 future leaders of the country. Mr. Graves was an administrative assistant to the late Senator Robert Kennedy, and after the senator's death, established his own management consultant firm. Today, among a whole host of activities, he serves on the Board of Governors, the Corporate Fund for the Performing Arts at the Kennedy Center, the Advisory Council of Notre Dame Center of Civil Rights, and the Visiting Committee of Harvard's John F. Kennedy School of Government. In 1979, he was appointed a member of the Presidential Committee for Small and Minority Businesses and is president of the Board of Directors of the American Business Council. He's a graduate of Morgan State University in Baltimore, majoring in economics, and has received honorary Doctor of Law degrees from numerous universities, including his own, that is Morgan State, as well as Wesleyan University in Connecticut. He's also served as a lecturing fellow at Yale University. It's with great pleasure that I introduce Mr. Earl G. Graves, who comes to us today in economic times that can only be described as in crisis, and particularly so for the Black community. He speaks to us on the subject, achieving equal economic opportunity, a remedy for America's ills. Mr. Graves.
Thank you, Nelson. As I listened to your introductory remarks, and you said you were abbreviating, I kind of thought that you had gotten the bio sent to you by my mother last night, but I don't think you're that very much out. It's interesting to me as we look back at biographical data that after, when I first received that award in 1972 as one of the most outstanding minority business people in the country, they used to say who the president was. And then the president, who was then the president, had that little difficulty in Washington. His name was Nixon. And now they only say the president gave him an award. So there was some question as to how long I was going to speak. And at least 10 different people have described to me what happens here this afternoon. And it ranges anywhere from 15 minutes to, if you go beyond 1:30, you'll be standing there by yourself. 20 people have asked me how long they're going to speak. And so it gives me some indication of the feeling of the audience, and I will try to be sensitive to that. If someone at the table was asking me that had the publishing part of our business felt any downturn in the present economic situation, particularly circulation, I said, no, the circulation numbers are up. The problem is when people say bill me today, they really mean it the hereafter. And so that part of our business has become interesting as we have taken on several law firms to explain to people that bill me means in this life rather than in the later life. Needless to say, it is a real honor and pleasure for me to be here today with the members of the City Club of Cleveland. I consider Cleveland to be my adopted city. And several years ago when I received the key to this great city, I remember telling Lou and Carl Stokes that I would put the key to good use. I've done that by visiting Cleveland and its concerned elected officials, community and business leaders many times. Last year when I spoke to the members of Operation Alert, I was extremely impressed with the depth and quality of their concerns as leaders in this city. I'm happy to say my impression is even more reinforced today as I meet more of you. In accepting your kind invitation, I feel privileged to have joined the distinguished company of so many prominent Americans who have addressed this gathering in recent years. And to follow your esteemed governor, Governor Celeste, is indeed an honor. I'm also delighted that my thoughts can be shared with so many others who can't be with us physically today, but who will be able to share our hour through radio and television. I'm also pleased that so many of those stations that will be picking up this broadcast are part of the National Public Radio, as I serve as a member of the Board of Directors of National Public Radio in Washington. Since this unique forum began some 70 years ago, many speakers have offered their thoughts and insights on war and peace, the Great Depression, nuclear disarmament, and other problems which begged workable solutions and whose consequences were too grim to imagine. It is no secret that I am the publisher of Black Enterprise magazine and that my dedication to the principle of real economic opportunity for all Americans is the driving force behind both my professional and personal lives. So you'll not be surprised that I'm going to speak this afternoon about the intolerable price we as a society and as individuals continue to pay for the lack of real economic opportunity in America. I know that the city of Cleveland, and particularly the City Club of Cleveland, is very aware and concerned about relations between races in this city and its surrounding communities. There were few communities in America where there was such genuine concern and dedicated hard work by leaders from community organizations, churches, and businesses to try and prove that relations can be improved and work. A very good example of this is a recent survey of race and ethnic relations by the Greater Cleveland Roundtable, where my good friend Sarah Austin serves as executive director. I worked with Sarah at the National Urban Coalition, where her work is legend. And now, because of her dedication in this city and because of the care and support of the members of the Roundtable, Cleveland has an accurate view of just where it is and where it must go in the near future. I can't speak of civic leadership without mentioning the contributions of my good friend John Bustamante. His leadership in the world of banking has proven beyond a doubt that investments in black-owned businesses and in urban communities can pay dividends beyond that which one is normally measured by in looking at business. His leadership in civic activities sets an example for all of us of how a successful businessman can assist in improving the quality of life in his community just by taking the time and effort to become involved. All of these outstanding efforts by so many really make a difference. It makes a difference for responsible elected officials such as City Council President George Forbes and others who do an outstanding job representing the needs of all of the citizens of this city. It makes a difference in the number of black elected and appointed officials and responsible persons in local government here. And it even makes a difference in the media coverage of important and sensitive issues that affect race relations. And all of this certainly makes an impact on the success of black-owned business in this part of the country. 7 of Black Enterprise Magazine's top 100 black-owned businesses are located right here in Ohio. And 3 of those businesses are located here in Cleveland. Some of those same representatives are here today. The STR Corporation was 26th on the BE100 list last year with sales of $17.8 million. Royal Ridge Management was 92nd on the list with sales of $7.5 million. And Homes A Construction was 94th with sales of $7.2 million. The other 4 Black Enterprise 100 companies from Ohio were Bob Ross Buick of Centerville with $15.5 million in sales, William Cargill Contracting of Cincinnati with $11.5 million in sales, Time Chevrolet of Delaware with $7.9 million in sales, and Landmark Ford Sales of Fairfield with $7.5 million in sales. As publisher of Black Enterprise, I've had the good fortune to be able to record a very important decade of American history. I can tell you firsthand that the businessmen and businesswomen here in Cleveland and throughout the nation who are responsible for the continued growth and development of black-owned businesses have displayed as much individual brilliance, dedication, and determination as any group of Americans in our history. The total revenues of the top Black Enterprise 100-owned companies grew by 24.2% in the past year, from $1.5 billion to just a fraction short of $2 billion. more important than the substantial growth in the past year is the meaningful overall progress that the top 100 companies have made in the past decade. 10 years ago, the first black enterprise list totaled only $473 million in sales. As I stated just earlier, the 1982 list came very close to $2 billion in sales. When adjusted for inflation, this marked a real increase of more than 80%. The bottom line is at least the top 100 black-owned businesses in America grew at a rate of more than three times that of the economy at large during that past decade. That's an incredible achievement when one looks at the unrelenting inflation, an energy crisis, a continuing struggle for problems of access to credit from new markets and from much of the financial world, including and even recently the government stopping us in terms of the resources we needed. Although the vast majority of black-owned businesses in America are still small and struggling, it is crucially important to keep in mind the success of the top 100 black-owned businesses. For this successful history has been written and continues to be written, despite the fact that real economic opportunity is not the rule in America today. This record of excellence and achievement by leading black-owned businesses in America proves beyond a shadow of a doubt that the potential for economic health and social well-being that awaits this nation when we reach the day when all American citizens will have an equal right to succeed or fail, that should happen despite the color of their skin. If you remember anything of what I say today, I hope it will be this. However inspiring and important the history of the leading black-owned businesses is, there is much more at stake than the history of the top 100 or even the leading 1,000 black-owned businesses in this country. I'm not a man who succumbs to the temptation of hyperbole, but it is no exaggeration to say that both the social fabric and economic security of this nation depend in a large measure on how fairly and equally economic opportunity, including the capital for businesses to expand and grow, and the opportunity for fair and equal employment is distributed in coming years. I bring a message that is both obvious and simple, yet it would do more to improve the social fabric of life and to restore economic harmony in this city and every community in America than any other possible action. The message is simply for everyone to make economic justice his or her number one priority and to erase once and for all the economic legacy of racism in our society. The answer is for all Americans of all races, religions, and economic backgrounds, in both public and private enterprise, to fight for economic justice as if the very survival of America depended on the outcome. For it does. Let me be more specific. Two figures from the 1980 census, our most recent figures, I mean the government's most recent census figures, gives a more accurate view of the current state of equal economic opportunity in America. More so than any words I could use. The median income for white families in America was $21,914, while the median income for black families in America was $12,674. So despite the economic progress that many black Americans have made in the past decade, the economic gap between the races has not begun to close. And more than a decade since the Kerner Commission predicted that this nation was headed towards two separate and unequal societies, our societies are more separate and more unequal than they were when our cities exploded in rage and economic frustration in the late 1960s. This nation, said President John F. Kennedy, was founded on the principle that all men are created equal and that the rights of every man are diminished when the rights of one man are threatened. Outside of this room right now, double-digit unemployment rages at a painful rate, a rate that we have not seen since the Great Depression. Meanwhile, the lack of real economic opportunity in our nation is again documented in the fact that unemployment for black Americans remains at least twice as high as the rest of our citizens. The real human tragedy in all of this can be found here in Cleveland, and in other central cities of America, where unemployment among young black men and women is measured anywhere from 35 to 70%. We are raising a whole generation that does not know what it is like to have the simple opportunity to work for a living. We are condemning a whole generation to a future of hopelessness and despair because their rights to a living are diminished, because they are prisoners in the absence of opportunity. All of our rights are diminished, and the future of our nation is seriously threatened. Let me hasten to say that I'm not insensitive to or unconcerned about the unemployment problems that face the majority of white citizens in this country, and specifically areas like Warren and Lordstown, Youngstown, Campbell, and Struthers in the northeastern section of this state. It was tragic to read the piece in the Wall Street Journal about the problems that face the citizens of that community, and one can only be concerned. We at Black Enterprise are so concerned with this tragic situation that last year we convened an esteemed group of economists who are meeting on a regular basis to try to come to grips with the devastating economic problems that face Black American families today. The Black Enterprise Board of Economists includes Dr. Marcus Alexis from Northwestern University, Dr. Bonner Addison of the University of Pennsylvania and the Rockefeller Foundation, Dr. William Bradford of the University of Maryland, Dr. Andrew Brimmer of Brimmer & Company, Sir Arthur Lewis, a Nobel laureate of Princeton University, Dr. Glenn Lowry of Harvard University, Dr. Alfred Osborne of UCLA, and Dr. Phyllis Wallace of the Massachusetts Institute of Technology. After their first meeting, that is our Board of Economists, they concluded that unless there is some dramatic improvement in the unemployment situation for young blacks, we as a people and as a nation face the uncertain, unthinkable prospect of witnessing the total destruction of the black family unit. And it is hard to find words to describe the intensity of emotion that, and concern which I know we all share on this crucial issue. The Black Enterprise Board of Economists will meet again in March of this year, having met only in October and taken another look in terms of economically where our nation is. A report on their deliberations that took place in October will be included as a special feature of our March issue. We all know how devastating being unemployed is for individuals without jobs, but it is also doing a great fiscal damage to urban America and to the city and state governments that are now feeling a direct result of the unemployment, as people who have lost their jobs are forced to stop paying taxes. This, in turn, is causing further reduction in layoffs of city and state workers who perform vital services, and a measurable deterioration in the quality of American life is seen in these cities. A look at how black Americans are represented in key professions will provide another barometer of where we are today. About 3.5% of this nation's lawyers are black. That is out of 522,000 lawyers in this country. And roughly 5% of America's 777,000 physicians are black. Less than 6% of engineers and 4% of the technicians in America are black when we are moving to a society that only says high technology. And about 5% of all managers and administrators in this nation are black. In the communications industry, where I make my living, the record is even worse. There are 9,140 radio stations in this country, and only 128 are owned by blacks. There are 1,060 television stations in America having nothing to do with cable stations. Only 11 are owned by blacks. Of the more than 11,000 editors and reporters who work for major owned companies in this country, less than 6% are black. I could spend all afternoon reading facts and figures, but by now you should have a good idea of the high price we are paying for the absence of economic justice in this nation, and it goes beyond facts and figures. An example of this is a recent study that was done in my hometown, New York City. It showed that about one-third of our city's high school students, a predominant number of who are both black and brown, chronic truths. Whatever reasons the experts may give for this deplorable situation, one thing is clear. Because of the absence of equal economic opportunity for these youngsters to succeed or fail in their pursuits of employment and careers, far too many give up on life in this great nation before their lives have really begun. I'm not saying this is right. I'm not making excuses for these young people. What I'm saying is the problems are real. And we must mount a massive effort to address these tragedies, and soon. Or we must be prepared to face the consequences that are too grim to imagine. There are some recent initiatives in the area of education and employment preparation that are worth our support. Governor Jim Hunt of North Carolina and Frank Kerry, the chairman of IBM, have formed a high-powered partnership that is designed to assist high school students who face dismal employment opportunities. Governor Hunt and Frank Kerry have assembled a task force consisting of 11 governors, 3 state legislators, 6 prominent educators, 2 scientists, a labor leader, and heads of 11 major corporations. Their goal is to put together a highly visible national program to help attain the level of skills that these students need in order to make it in today's marketplace of high technology. One area they should certainly consider, and one I will bring to their attention, is how to make job training potential represented in minority-owned businesses become more of a reality. Our businesses, minority-owned businesses, are struggling to acquire the capital they need to make further inroads into high-technology growth markets, thereby becoming more labor-intensified. By giving minority-owned businesses the opportunities they have earned to grow and expand, these major corporations and units of government will be creating opportunities for jobs and job training and real opportunity employment for many black men and women who deserve the fundamental right to work for a living. And speaking of aware corporations struggling to make a profit while being sensitive to the needs of the total community, I'd be remiss if I did not mention the Goodyear Tire Rubber Company of this state. Matt Brown of that company is here today, and he speaks to and represents many of the programs that they are concerned with and they should be concerned with. And I would say to you that they set an example that many corporations around this country would do well to follow. You should be pleased to have them as a part of your state. I was pleased to see that during President Reagan's recent visit to Chicago, he announced his support for immediate governmental action to affect new training and employment opportunities for America's unemployed and for its youth. And I'm speaking of the visit he only made this week. After some 2 years of neglect, another area he addressed himself to and has come up with a specific program to expand his economic opportunity for minority-owned businesses. The president has pledged that the federal government will spend some $15 billion with minority-owned firms over the next 3 years. In addition, President Reagan pledged to increase efforts to encourage prime contractors doing business with the federal government to subcontract with minority-owned firms. Finally, he promised $1.5 billion in desperately needed credit assistance for minority-owned firms. I was invited to the White House for the announcement of this new initiative, and I'm delighted with what the president said about the importance of our businesses and what he has promised to do to help. Now it will be up to us, all of us, to make sure that those promises are kept. It is no coincidence, however, that this announcement came, surprisingly enough, 1 month after the results of the November elections. While the average national voter turnout was about 39% of registered voters, the average turnout of minority voters ranged between 45 and 55%. In many elections where the margin of victory was narrow, minority voters made the difference between defeat and victory for many candidates. I've often said that black Americans have both the political clout and the economic clout to make the real economic opportunity in this country a reality. In November reflects our political muscles. And black Americans are beginning to also flex their economic muscles now by spending their dollars where they will do the most good for real economic opportunity. On the products and services I'm speaking of companies that make it a practice to do business with minority-owned firms and which practice equal opportunity in their hiring and promotional policies. The total income of the black families in this country is about $149 billion a year. Conservative estimates predict that it will grow to more than $225 billion by 1985. That's enough to mean the difference between profit and loss for nearly any company. as some companies under public pressure to practice equal opportunity are realizing and discovering, some with a little pain, but certainly not too late. But we cannot complete this job by ourselves. If we are to erase the economic legacy of racism in America before it is too late, we must again form coalitions to battle for economic justice with the same determination and sense of purpose that inspired the civil rights movements in the 1960s. We must band together again to win the other half of the battle to erase the economic injustice that still permeates our land. So I have to ask you, in the end, what good will it do for us to gain all the rights in the world if Black Americans continue to suffer the unequal pain of economic discrimination? We're not talking about charity. We've never asked for a handout. Black businessmen and businesswomen simply want the opportunity to succeed or fail. Right now, our biggest stumbling block is a lack of access to capital for growth and expansion. I'm certain that if I were to begin Black Enterprise magazine today, I would find it more difficult, if not impossible, to secure the capital that was available to me 13 years ago. Because of a special program by a major national bank, I was able to borrow the necessary financing to launch Black Enterprise in 1970, when interest rates were 8%, if you remember those days. Today, that program no longer exists. Today, despite the fact that a large number of our businesses have the managerial expertise and technical know-how to expand into more labor-intensive industries, it is harder than ever to obtain capital at any interest rate. Despite the proven track records of the nation's leading Black-owned businesses, a majority of America's major financial institutions still view making prudent investments with minority-owned businesses as an automatic high-risk venture. These are the same multinational banks that are in fiscal jeopardy for lending billions of American dollars to nations around the globe. Now, we must raise our voices and ask those major institutions how they can afford to take such risk in foreign lands, risk that add very few dollars to the severely depressed American economy or do very little in the way of gathering and creating jobs for America's unemployed, while at the same time, they ignore the lucrative investment potential of minority-owned American companies with proven track records. These institutions certainly owe the American public at large an answer. Before I end and take your questions, I want to personally ask each of you to do all that you can in the places where you live and work to make real economic opportunity a reality in America. It is a cause that will only bring this nation closer to living up to the promises of our Constitution. It is a cause that will cure so many of our social and economic ills that no patriotic American can afford to ignore it. For one thing is certain, when Black Americans are able to enjoy equal economic opportunity and to obtain their fair share of this nation's economic benefits, our cities and our nation will know a prosperity and social harmony they have never before experienced. Federal, state, and local governments will be relieved of the trillions of dollars they now spend to support the victims of economic injustice. And we will finally be able to say without hesitation that America is the land of opportunity for all. I will leave you with the words of my friend Corey Eklund, the chairman of the Equitable Life Assurance Society of the United States, another outstanding company in recognizing its responsibilities to the total citizenry of this country. As he said when he addressed the Capitol Hill Symposium, together we must strive to achieve the fullest measure of the American dream and to preserve the precious social, economic, and political system that gives promise to its fuller realization. To do less is to have less faith in America. Thank you for inviting me to be a speaker this afternoon. Thank you very much, Mr. Graves. Today at the City Club, we're listening to Earl G. Graves, publisher of Black Enterprise magazine. We are deeply indebted to the Cleveland Business League for helping us in bringing Mr. Graves to speak before us today.
In just a moment, we'll turn to our question period, but first, a few announcements. Now that we're settled into our new quarters here in the Citizens Building, we're planning all sorts of exciting programs. And this is an ideal time for those of you who are not now official members of the City Club to consider seriously becoming a member. The dues are modest. There is no interest fee. Everyone is welcome. We are a completely open, quasi-public organization. We invite you to join with us. Right now, today, stop by our office at 850 Euclid Avenue, downtown Cleveland, or call us at 621-0082. Today, again, we have students with us who are participating in our Living Seminars program, which we sponsor in cooperation with the Cleveland Public Schools and Cuyahoga Community College. With us now are students from the following schools: Erie U Catholic, Euclid, Laurel, Max S. Hayes, Padua, and Cleveland School of Science. Will they stand, please, to receive our welcome? Thank you. They will be meeting with Mr. Graves for their own seminar right after our forum here. Next week, our speaker will be Dr. Janet Norwood, United States Commissioner of Labor Statistics. Her topic will be employment and prices. What has been happening? Be sure to make your reservations early for this major address. Now for our questions for Mr. Graves. We have two microphones, one at the front with Alan Davis, one at the rear with Bob Conrad. Raise your hand to be recognized. We'll move on to the first question.
Mr. Graves, I thought that last line of the economic problems was about as eloquent as any we have ever heard yet. The only thing that I did not get from Bateman's speech was any comments, suggestions, recommendations as to what we ought to do about it. I think the outline was superb. The solutions were not visible. I'd just like to ask you, what if you were in charge somewhere nationally, what it is you would do with the only request that you would exclude from your recommendations the idea of forming another committee to think about it?
First of all, he said, I'm not going to propose any number of times that I should be in charge. And I said a little tongue in cheek. But I would hope that some of the things I said struck a note with some person here in the audience beyond just the fact that I stated all the problems. One of the things I think we do historically in Black Enterprise Magazine and have for the last 12 years of publishing is not only to state the problems, but to identify some solutions. Now, in speaking on behalf of minority business development, I clearly said that the number one problem facing minority business people in this country is access to capital. The financial institutions of this city and the financial institutions of states throughout this country are woefully lacking in their wisdom, if you will, of making the capital available that can only make a difference not only within the minority communities, but in terms of the improving of the situation that exists in the total community in general. So clearly, as I go around the country making speeches, the number one area that I speak to is the ability to have the access to develop a business or start it up, if you will, to meet your day-to-day cash flow needs, and of course to expand that business by acquiring other businesses. And I would hope that financial institutions becoming involved is one area. The awareness of the private sector to want to try to solve some of the problems, and I'm not speaking about it in a way that President Reagan does, of identifying that what we need to do is just have an enterprise zone and that will solve the problems, but to clearly have a base for wanting to solve some problems because it's in their best interest financially as a company is another area that I've seen changes happening. The kind of program that Frank Kerry is talking about, and Governor Hunter is talking about, of training these young people so that they can be qualified for the jobs that are going to be open, that will be open in the last quarter of this century, all having to do with high technology. It is an area, again, where I think that major corporations can make a difference, but there has to be incentives beyond something like a free enterprise zone. I would also like to believe that in the hiring opportunities that are available, irrespective of whether or not you're speaking of the law firms of this country, where there are probably less than of the major partners in this country. I doubt seriously there are 100 black partners in this country, if that many. And I'm using law firms for example because there's some of the other representatives there. And because I'm going back to law firm, I mean, speaker for 2 hours, I figured I might as well lean on it. But whether or not you're speaking of law firms, you're speaking of some of the major corporations here in the city, we have got to stop, or you have got to stop giving us jobs that has to do with the dotted line that can be erased off of a flowchart at any time. We have gone beyond having the jobs that have equal opportunity written behind it as a title or in front of it. We no longer need to be vice president of dark secrets. We need to be. I want our sons, we have 3 sons, to have the opportunity to be the purchasing agent at your company, or the financial vice president at your company, or if he elects to and is qualified to become the president of your company. And if I had daughters, I'd want her to have the opportunity. That's my 3 sons.
Ms. Graves, Frantz Fanon asked the question, when looking at crisis throughout the black world, how do we extricate ourselves? My question to you regarding the people who are 117 years out of slavery and have less than 15 years before the 21st century is, how do we synthesize our economic behavior, $200 billion that we spend every year? Continued social work stances on various states of black America without economic component, and our failure, in the words of Dr. Goodlatte of California, to turn around in clout fashion from the domestic worker to the PhD level, the money we have to spend.
I think the economic, I mean, to answer your question, is unfortunate having time for each person to identify themselves directly when he's asking the question. But I think that the economic tenure of the times is dictating that we're bringing ourselves together. It doesn't much matter whether you're talking about the program that Jesse Jackson was talking about, which we have endorsed and which most black leaders around this country have endorsed, and that is to, I knew when I said Jesse Jackson, I would get it done. It doesn't much matter that who has endorsed the program. The point is that most black leaders have indeed endorsed and support what it is he is talking about, and that is that we have a coming together of using our clout economically and politically. Now, as I said in the speech, which hopefully you heard that part, we have 2 kinds of clout, and most people do. That is economic clout and political clout. We use the political clout with the ballot box. I'm just talking now about using our economic clout by voting with our dollars. It is very disturbing to me that about a week that goes by that some young person, male or female, does not call me to you, has graduated from some of the finest institutions in this country, is working at some bank, has their MBA from one of the finest business schools, and he or she finds themselves pigeonholed or dead-end in terms of where they're going. Those young people who are very qualified are their counterparts who may not be qualified at all because those students who dropped out of the New York City high schools. Those same young people and their parents who are unemployed, there has to be, I see, coming together a real formation and coalition of those groups to make a difference. Our Board of Economists, interestingly enough, has said for the ministers that are here that they may not be the same ministers who are in position now, but they clearly see the church and the black community again playing a role in bringing together the black community in terms of what we have to do. And I do not see it happening otherwise. You need to know that I believe that the problems that face us are so enormous when you start talking about young people having 75% unemployment and not being educated so they can do otherwise, that it's going to take a total coming together of this community. And I see it happening in enough places, whether it's in black professional organizations, whether or not it's in fraternal groups, whether or not it is in local community groups. I can only say to you that I do not think what you have seen in terms of the last 10 years of what you will see in terms of how quiet we will be in the next 10 years. And let me hasten to say before the reporters, I'm not saying that we're going to have riots, because as soon as you say quiet, then that means the opposite of quiet is noise, and what does noise mean? I'm saying to you that the leverage we can exercise is going to be not modest in terms of what I think we can do.
Mr. Graves, there was an article in the Wall Street Journal within the last 2 or 3 days.
That's a very simple quote.
You read that? This was written by Thomas Sowell, and it was on the editorial page of the Wall Street Journal, and it addressed the subject of the small number of black engineers. If you didn't read the article, are you familiar with his point of view?
Are very familiar with
his point of view? He's a wonderful writer, but I'm never quite sure what he's saying at the end. And I think he said in that article that it was all right that there are a small number of black engineers and engineering students. If you can explain to me what his philosophy is and how you agree with it or don't agree with it, I'd appreciate that.
I think he plays a major burden on the answer to explain his philosophy. But Thomas Sowell, for those who don't know, is well-known because of the press, black economist. I say to you because of the press, because with the advent of the Reagan administration, because he was very much to the right in his economic thinking, and how he reflected our concerns as a black community, he became the darling of the right-wing press. So therefore, he is quoted in the Wall Street Journal, and he is quoted substantially on television, and there's hardly a Sunday or weekend that goes by that they don't have him on now as the expert on the black community. It gives comfort to those who are presently in power because he is saying those things, which allows those who want to see things stay as a status quo to continue to exist. I do not philosophically agree with what it is the position he takes. He's well educated and he's very bright. I just think he is misguided in terms of the concerns. I know that it is in his room, he might probably not be as charitable, but in any event, I just think that he is not on the track in terms of the problems that face us as a community. And when he says that we have to lift ourselves up with our bootstraps even if we don't have boots, I think that is a little out of touch with reality. I can only ask you to, he has a book, and I'm not very much pushing his book, but his book does get into his philosophy. And I can't help but believe after you get to the final page if you will think that that is the direction we have to move on as a country and specifically as black people. And whatever he said, you're saying that he says it's already got a small number of engineers and they'd be black. But clearly that is a mistake, and I don't even think that's worth a discussion, if that's the point you're making.
Mr. Graves, the question is what can we do? I know something we can do right now, and that's put pressure on Congress to vote for the funding to implement the Humphrey Hawkins full employment bill. That's already a law on the books, and apparently everybody's forgotten about it.
I don't disagree with that. I agree with that, but I also think it's not going to take just that bill. It's going to take a substantial number of, I think, incentives. It's going to take a substantial number of efforts on the part of this administration. I think that the pressure that's going to be necessary can now be exercised by the total community of this country, specifically the black voting populace of this country. And I think that in the cities where we have that kind of clout, we're going to have to exercise that kind of clout. We're actually talking about that specific bill, which I have endorsed, and we have endorsed the Black Enterprise, and other things and other measures that must happen. President Reagan just visiting one high school in Chicago, when you look at the enormity of the problems in Chicago alone, it's just not dealing with the reality of the enormity of the problems that face us. I told someone sitting at this table that we are moving our corporate headquarters in New York City to another part of the city, to Lower Manhattan. And our budget for construction, because of the problems of the city, is 10% of our construction budget is going to security, buses, alarms, lights. But that says something about our society when you construct an office and 10% of the construction is devoted to that kind of thing. We have to do something so that the young people and those persons who do not have jobs, because a person who doesn't have a job nor an opportunity has nothing to lose. And that's what we're really dealing with in our society. It's just not a matter of kids wanting to knock someone in the head, but it is so despicable what it is that they are facing that I guess certainly do not endorse the crime that we have, but you need to understand we have to have some way of addressing it. As the moral leader of this country, in addition to being the political leader, President Reagan and his administration has just got to do otherwise from where he is today.
Graves, have you been active in the proposed boycott of movies that Dr. Hooks has been working on this past year or so? Movie industry boycotting the type of genre of movies that depict blacks in a, let's say, a pre-1964 manner?
Well, I don't think you're accurate. I think part of what you're describing is happening in another way, but I think you're totally identifying the total issue as far as Dr. Hooks is concerned. What the National Governor's Office is doing is going to the major movie studios and saying, not only what you just described, that we no longer can be depicted as the guys who carry the bags in the movies, but as someone who manufactured the bags also, but we have to have a piece of the action that should, in
terms of job opportunities. And when you look at the major studios and you see that we are not visible in any sense of the imagination, we did a cover story, I think it was last year with Jim Brown and Robert Raintree and some others on the cover. And when you look at our visibility in terms of the jobs we have at the studios, whether or not it's behind the camera where we are not visible here in this room today, or whether or not, and I'm not, that's not an indictment of those here, though I want you to go back and worry about it, or whether or not you look at those who are writing the scripts and who is buying them, or whether or not you look at the concessionaires, or you look at the host of things that have to do with driving the very vans that the actors sit in, we're not there. And Ben Hooks is saying, this cannot continue to be. And what are you suggesting is one more time is that we're going to vote with our dollars. We should not support any of the major studios who are not going to be sensitive to the concerns and needs of the disadvantaged communities of this country. And don't bother to tell me if you could really find me somebody very smart about who want to hire them. Because we're talking about more than just them. We're talking about hundreds of people who ought to be able to find jobs and should be able to find them. And that's what he's talking about. So the project program is only about 10% of the issue.
Yes, Mr. Graves, I enjoyed your presentation. And the question that I have for you is, I worked for a major corporation here in the Cleveland area for 14 years as their affirmative action officer. I acted on the laws of affirmative action and was wrongfully separated from the company. And my question to you is, what would you suggest that I do?
All the lawyers in the room, raise your hand. I don't say that to be facetious at all, but first of all, I think it is clearly a legal issue. If I were facing the same problem that you are describing, and there's been times that I certainly have, and I don't think there's very many black people in their professional business careers who will go through an entire lifetime and not facing some of what it is you have faced. You need to know that you're not the lone ranger, if you will, in terms of the problem you're facing. I mean, that's satisfied in terms of the problem. I do think that there are some persons here today, who are all the lawyers, raise your hand, no doubt you should say. But here's Tom McDonald right here. Tom can take it back to the law, and I don't know, and I don't want you to sit down exasperated with the thing, but I do think that this is a legal matter you're speaking to, and also Matt Brown, Matt, raise your hand. He is here from Goodyear. He has dealt with enough of these problems and looked at enough of them, certainly at Goodyear, and I'm not saying to you they're solving all their problems right, but he could at least give you a square shoulders answer in terms of what you might do. And I don't think you ought to just walk away from it. I do think you ought to fight the thing, because even given the position of the present administration, I still think that there's ways to fight what it is you describe if you have a basis for or a case for it. I think that's where a lawyer has to tell you whether or not you do. Fine, could one of your lawyers join me, sir?
Mr. Graves, I have a question I'd like to ask you, but I just wanted to divert a little bit to the statement that you made a minute ago with respect to the article in the Wall Street Journal. I'm a director of marketing for an architectural engineering firm that's been a minority, back-owned architectural engineering firm that's been in business in Cleveland for 28 years. And I'm all here to tell you that there are less engineers, black engineers and architects, that are coming out of engineering and architectural schools today. And it was 10 years ago when I was in school, and 35 years ago when my father was in school. And I would suggest that you write that down in a letter, and everybody else here, to affirm the fact that we need more engineers, more black engineers, more black architects, and more blacks in the high technology areas, because if they're not there, we're not going to be able to compete. We are competing now, and we certainly won't be able to compete in the future. To get to my question, Mr. Graves, I read the press release of the meeting that you attended. I'm glad to meet someone that attended that press conference that the president held December 15th to December 16th of last year, in which he stated there was going to be $15 billion was going to be channeled to minority businesses over the next 4 years, another additional $7 billion in other areas, and $1.5 billion in assistance, and another $5 billion in new starts for minority businesses. I want to know what, but I have talked to Congressional Black Caucus members who told me this is just media hype. The president that's just something that he stated at that point. And you mentioned here, you suggested we watch this.
who's responsible for it, and who should the parents have to respect to?
Well, first of all, I knew there'd be a question eventually. There's the Office of Minority Business Development in Washington, and there is a head of that, Mr. Rivera, who I would like to and ask, where is this in terms of the discipline you're interested in? I do not think it is fair until he's proven otherwise. It's politically too easy for us to give you a shot. He's not going to do anything. I happen to think that he's considering running again in 1984. Having reached his halfway point yesterday, he is indeed going to have to do some things. And if he's talking about getting elected again, if he is not more serious about us, he might as well forget about becoming elected again. So I think that you can look to him, and I would write and start off by writing to the Minority Business Office in Washington and asking specifically. And then if you don't get an answer, you're going to get a satisfactory answer. And so send us to reply, and I will print your reply so that they know that somebody's helping with this question.
Mr. Graves, you made a number of very positive suggestions as to how blacks can be helped who are being discriminated against, who are in executive or professional or specially trained positions. But I really see that as on the tip of the iceberg. And to the vast number of blacks who are unemployed, who have no training, who have little or no education beyond some very primary education, can you give us some real specifics as to how those people can be helped?
Now, I happen to think that many of the programs that were cut by this present administration were not programs that should have been cut. I think the CEDA program made a real difference in New York City, and I think Bobby must have here in Cleveland in terms of what that program did. I happen to think that the jobs program that the president is speaking to, or spoke to earlier this week in Chicago, is not sufficient for the, obviously, the enormity of the problem that faces them. Even in the jobs where you have the tax on the gasoline, which will potentially provide a restructuring, if you will, of the infrastructure of our highways and byways, that is not going to fill the gap to us. I know that ought to be an area that we could look to because the construction unions historically around this country have only let us tear down buildings and not put things back up. And I don't see that changing in time for that level of employment to make a difference. I think it's going to take a massive jobs effort, such as we described by my fellow editor in the back, having to do with guaranteeing a job. I think it's going to take a massive job effort in terms of retraining people, and it's going to take a commitment of dollars. Now, the question would have to be, where are those dollars going to come from? And before I say that we hold back on the defense budget, I just want to say to you that we have enough dollars to wipe out the world right now. And if President Reagan was serious about trying to find a safety valve for this thing, he would pick up the telephone and arrange to meet the Russians somewhere and sit down and really start to work it out. And I'm saying this to you as a person who used to be a captain in the Green Berets and ate snakes and jumped out of airplanes, so I'm certainly not a person who's not familiar with the Army and concerned about having a strong military. I'm saying to you, we do not have to have the excesses that we do in the Pentagon budget. We do not have to have the excesses we have in terms of the overall budget that the president is proposing, which takes us all the way to 1986. And I think the Congress is addressing itself to that. My only hope is that when they cut those dollars back, that they go to fund the kind of programs that you and I are talking about.
And Mr. Graves, there is a growing spread of Arab people opening up businesses in the predominantly black neighborhood. I want to know if they have easier access in obtaining a small business loan, or how can we go about to eradicate this condition?
I'm not being facetious, but on March, one of our main stories, if you look at what's written in terms of what will come in March, for those of you who are seeing Black Enterprise for the first time, who will have subscriptions of you when the issue comes out, we are addressing ourselves to that very topic, not from the way that you would like to say, because I don't think that the Arab community, and you're talking really about the Asian community, not just talking about Asian, right? You're talking about people who are coming from Vietnam, but I think we have to be more charitable than that. But I happen to think that you need to read a Black Enterprise to see see what it is they have done and how they're doing it. It is not a matter of there is a coalescing and coming together of the resources they have that enables them to do it. There are people standing behind them. And unfortunately, they are being described as a safer minority. That is part of the problem also. It is kind of everybody got confused about hiring women a little while ago. And then all of a sudden, they realize, guys, they are qualified and now it's just accepted. They have not gotten enthused about the black and the brown community to the extent that you will read about in March, assuming you have a description of black enterprise about how that happened.
Mr. Graves?
Yes.
I feel this question is fair, but could you give us some statistics, general statistics, about the Hispanics and American Indians in the survey of economic problems that are in today?
I tell people that I'm more than that way when I start dealing with the problems of just the black community. I have to say, if you think historically, I don't know, I don't have exact statistics in front of me. I do know that the growth of the Hispanic community in terms of what it represents today and what it would be even by 1990 is very substantive and very substantial in terms of the clout that they will have both politically and economically also. The American Indian community historically has been held down, whether or not you're talking about our infamous Secretary of Interior Watt suggested that they ought to take the reservations back from because they never deserved them, or whether or not you're talking about the enormity of other problems we faced in the community. They are enormous in terms of the problems we're facing. I don't have complete statistics in front of me. If you're asking me whether or not I think that there's a window out there for some communication vehicle or some way for their concerns to be raised and communicated in a for-profit way or a non-for-profit way, I certainly think there is. I'm not suggesting that they become an Indian enterprise or that you have an Hispanic enterprise. Not anything I'm just saying that clearly there is a need to expound somewhere or to have a forum for the concerns of that community being raised and continue to be raised. I do think that, particularly as far as the Hispanic community is concerned, that they are doing a fair job. I'm not sure if I answered your question clearly, but I would try to do something like that.